السلام.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه. The second way that the scholars have proven the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is by the fitrah. This is the natural disposition that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the natural state that Allah has created us upon. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us, مَا مِن مَوْلُودٍ إِلَّا يُولَدُ عَلَى الْفِطْرَةِ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ, that there is no newborn except that he is born upon the fitrah. And Allah says, فِطْرَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَطَرَ النَّاسَ عَلَيْهَا. This is the fitrah of Allah that he has created mankind upon. So, what is this fitrah? This fitrah is that every single newborn, he is born upon this. Okay, so every newborn, he is born upon this fitrah that Allah is one, and Allah is the only one worthy of worship. And the Messenger alayhi salam is the one who told us that there is no newborn except that he's born on the fitrah. Then it is his parents who turn him into a Christian or a Jew or a fire worshipper, or in another narration, or they turn him into a mushrik. The point being, look, subhanAllah, every newborn child, if you were to leave that child upon the fitrah and there were no external influences, either from society or from the family or the parents, then that child would grow up knowing that none has the right to be worshipped but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, we find now even studies in the West, they are finding that children are now innately being born, as they say. There is an innate thing inside of mankind that they know that there is a creator, that there is a higher being, in their words. Ya'ani that they are being born upon the fitrah. Now the studies and the scientists and the psychologists and those people who analyze behavior, they are coming to this realization now that mankind is being created with a fitrah. So look, subhanAllah, when you find and you speak to somebody who has reverted to al-Islam, they say, when you speak about the oneness of Allah, they say, you know, I could feel something inside of me. I could feel this like flame inside of me reigniting. What are you doing? You're simply reigniting their fitrah. You're simply realigning their fitrah, that which had been corrupted by society or the family around them. And it led them to say that I'm an atheist. It led them to say that I'm a Jew or a Christian or a Hindu, whatever it might be. But when you come to Tawheed, the oneness of Allah, and the worshipping none but Allah, then this is the fitrah. You have it in you, I have it in me, every single newborn, every one of mankind, they were created upon the fitrah. But that fitrah, then it was corrupted, or that light, it was put out as a result of the parents or the society around them. So if we were to leave some children, a newborn child, and you were to leave it, and it somehow miraculously raised itself without any input from society, then it would be upon the fitrah which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created it upon. The third way that the scholars, they have proven the existence of Allah, is by the senses. By the senses themselves. And what this means is that you can make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and your dua is answered. And this is something that can be sensed. You sensed when you made dua, and then you see the results of that dua. So for example, in Al-Madinah, a man came while the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was on the minbar for the day of Al-Jum'ah, for the khutbah. And he said, O Messenger of Allah, the animals are dying, the crops are dying, we're suffering, we're in a state of loss. Why? Because there's no rain. There hadn't been rain in Al-Madinah for a long time, and due to that lack of water, there were some severe problems. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he raised his hands and he made dua. Okay, and the narrators, they mention that out of nowhere, this big cloud, it came and it began to form, and it moved over Al-Madinah and it began to rain, until they mention that the Messenger alayhi salam, no sooner had he descended from the minbar except that his beard was dripping wet. Subhanallah. He made that dua when there was not a single cloud in the sky. Yet by the time he had finished making that dua and he had lowered his hands, his beard was dripping wet with water. Allahu Akbar. Who is the one who answered his dua then? Not a single cloud in the sky, and he raises his hands, and then it suddenly begins to rain and rain and rain. until it rained for the entire week. And the Prophet alayhi salam was on the minbar. And the man came back and he said, "Oh Messenger of Allah, we're in a state of loss." Why? Because there's been too much rain. There's been too much rain. There's too much water now. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he raised his hands. And he made dua once again. And the clouds, they dispersed. And the Prophet alayhi salam, he made dua. And it rained around Al-Madinah, but not a single drop of rain. It fell in Al-Madinah. And in another narration, the Prophet ﷺ, he mentioned and he told us about three men who were traveling, and they went and they took shelter in a cave, and then a rock, a big boulder, it came and it blocked the entrance to that cave, and they were trapped inside of that cave. So the first of the three men, he made dua, and the rock, it moved a little bit. And then the second of the men, he made dua, and it moved a little bit more. And the third of the men, he made dua, and then it moved even more, and they were able to escape. Look, their dua, it had a physical effect on that boulder, subhanallah. Now one of us might come and he says, "No, these are just a hadith and, you know, they're not authentic." These are hadith which are sahih. So they reach the conditions, they fulfill the conditions of siha, ittisal al-sanad, bil-adl wa tam al-dabt, and mithlihi min awalihi ila akhirihi, min ghayri shudhuth wa la illatin qadiha. They fulfill these strict conditions, which if you study the sciences of hadith, you will know how strict these conditions of authenticity they are. Yet these ahadith, they fulfill those conditions, subhanallah. So we believe them and we have no doubt concerning them. Look, you have been in a situation, I have been in situations where you make dua, Allah answers your dua immediately. Or even after a short space of time, you made a dua and Allah answered that dua. Is that just coincidence? Did you make dua and just coincidentally whatever you asked for, it happened? Whatever difficulty you were facing, it was lifted off of you? No. It's because Allah is the one who heard your dua. Allah is the one who answered your dua. Allah is the one who gave you what you wanted or took you out of the situation of difficulty that you were facing. This is a proof for the existence of Allah, subhanallah. This is a proof that Allah exists because you made dua and you got what you wanted. You made dua and that difficulty was raised. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not exist, subhanallah, does this mean now? Look, who answered your dua then? How did this happen then? And look, we have to add a side point to this. If you make dua and your dua is not answered, that does not mean that Allah does not exist. Okay, understand this. Some people come and they say, "I made dua, Allah didn't answer my dua." That means Allah doesn't exist. A'udhu billah min thalik. Look. There may be a barrier to your dua. There are things which prevent your dua from being answered. So you need to lift these barriers, and maybe Allah knows that the thing that you are asking for is not good for you, so He doesn't give it to you. This is a blessing. In and of itself, this is Allah answering your dua. Allah is answering your dua. And remember, if you make dua and Allah doesn't give it to you in this life, He'll give you something much better in Al-Akhirah. So my dear brothers and sisters, these are the second and the third way that the scholars, they have proven the existence of Allah. The first is the fitrah, that natural disposition which we all have inside of us. And it can be corrupted and it can be covered up. But if you go in and you reinvigorate it, I promise you that flame, it will reignite by the permission of Allah. And the third way is the senses. So you made dua for something and it was granted to you by Allah, either in the short term or in the long term. This is from the proofs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists. And I'm conscious that I've gone over my 5 minutes. Lakin, I wanted to speak about these two things. And then inshallah, in the next episode, we're going to speak about the fourth proof that the scholars have mentioned for the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So until next time, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.